the very first cracker was mine, all mine, you know. And of course, the guy who's the chief suspect, we find out towards the very end of it, he was a monk. And he hasn't been in the real world, you know. Loads of monks are in the real world, I have to say. But you know, this guy isn't. And Fitz is aware of that quite early on. And then, if you're a Catholic, there are certain things you remember like that, certain things you'll never forget. And it's, who made you? God made me. Why did God make you? God made me to know him, love him, and save him in this world, and to be happy with him forever in the next. I could go on.
I know you've got a conscience. I know that deep down, you're a good man. I've been to the house twice, met the parents. Can you imagine what you've put them through? What they've been through. It's not grief. Grief is a process. They can't even begin that process thanks to you. It's desolation. Cold, bleak, numb desolation. The daughter they loved is down in the morgue in a refrigerated cupboard. Let them bury her. They have to bury her. People will say he was a killer, he was a butcher, but he did one decent thing. He confessed so they could bury their daughter.
Two pieces that obviously they belong together are Hillsborough from 1996 and Sunday 2002. They're really polemical drama documentaries. I mean, both those pieces come from anger, don't they?
They're not polemical. It's amazing, you know. I think what it is is the event is so horrific that you think it's biased, you know, or you think it's informed with rage. But actually, to write that kind of stuff, you've got to be cool. You've got to be detached. You know, you've got to get through an army of lawyers.
You were angry, though, weren't you?
I was very, very angry. But anger's not going to get you past the lawyers and the police. You know, the quickest people in the world to sue you are the police. So because what happened is horrific, people find it hard to accept. But accept it. There were two versions of Bloody Sunday. As you know, there was the Paul Greengrass version, yeah. And there was mine. Mm. And in mine, we went through every single killing, and it was absolutely horrific. For instance, a paratrooper passing a guy crawling on the floor, badly wounded, and taking aim and shooting the guy in the back again. You know, the killings were terrible. Savile vindicated everything we wrote.
I was going to say about that.
It was not polemical.
We
put the truth on the screen.
Yeah, but you should take the credit for that, because the Savile Report, which took a million years and tens of millions of pounds, essentially said everything that your drama said.
Exactly. And you know why? We spent 2 years there. 2 years. The process is more important than what you write, well, what you end up with, I think. And anybody who wanted to speak to me was able to speak to me. We empowered them. They allowed me to tell their story. Now there's problems with that. It's no good telling a story that's a lie. So the truth is paramount. But as far as possible, they were telling me their story, and I was retelling their story, but checking every single fact all along the way. Everything corroborated. You know, nothing in that drama that we were going to have to apologise for. You know, had to be the truth.
And the shooting still went on. And we were at the telephone box. And we could hear this man squealing. I couldn't tell you who he was or where he was. I don't want to die on my own. I don't want to die on my own. And Mr. McGuigan, he said, I can't stand this no longer. If I go out waving a white hanky, they won't shoot me. We tried to persuade him not to go. That man was determined. It took about 4 steps from the telephone box, waving his white hanky, and he got shot.
As your career went on, there were two things that a lot of people believed, the veterans of British television believed. They believed in this thing called the single play, and they said that was the absolute. And they also believed that a single writer had to write every episode. Now, you've moved away from both of those, because on the American model, particularly in The Lakes and then all the subsequent stuff, The Street, Accused, you bring in other writers.
Yeah.
But also for you, it's been the serial, hasn't it, rather than the, or series, rather than the one-off play.
Yeah, but often they could stand alone as dramas anyway. The Street was like that, wasn't it? The only linkage was The Street, you know.
The Street is really the old play for today, isn't it?
It is,
They're single plays, but presented as a series.
Exactly, because it's nice to go to the BBC or whomever and say it's a series, and yet have that freedom to tell, you know, one-off dramas. I believe that the most important thing is story. It's not the ability of the writer. The most, because if you're a great writer and your story is crap, it's going to be crap, you know. So that's where we start off from. And there's a good piece in Adventures in the Screen Trade where he says he goes
William Goldman,
William Goldman says nobody has ever said, this is a great story, unfortunately the guy can't write, therefore let's pass on it. They say, this is a great story, let's make it work, you know. And that's what we do on The Street. This is a great story. Now, I do believe in ownership of story. So if somebody comes to us with a great story, we will allow them to write it. We will help them to write it. But there might come a time when they cannot write it anymore. They've written it the best they can. And then I will work on it then. And that gives the thing a consistent authorial voice. Obviously, you get some writers, you change very little. Mm-hmm. You know, some of them are wonderful writers. But we do change things, and we always will. I think so. All that matters is the story. The ego of the writer is, you know, who gives a damn? The story matters. You know, have we told the story in the best way we can?
And The Street, which in terms of awards per series is one of the most successful shows there's ever been, and in terms of the audience, but it's so fundamentally you to come back to where we started this interview. Those moral dilemma plots that your Jesuit teachers would have loved. For me, one of the most powerful episodes of The Street, which is at a very loose tangent from the James Bulger case, but is essentially, what would it be like if you met in the street the person who had killed your child when they were a child?
That took time because murder of James Bulger traumatised the city, and I just kept thinking about, you know, would it be possible for those two boys to atone? If you kill as a child, how can you possibly understand the enormity of what you've done? You know, how can you atone for something you do not even understand? And also, you know, there's a wonderful moment in that where he says he can't live with his guilt, and yet he expects her to live with her grief. And which is the greater?
You can still function, make choices. A woman with a missing child is paralysed. But that's nothing to what comes next. The realisation that your child might be dead. And then the realisation that your child is probably dead. Almost certainly dead. That's terror. But I would gladly live the rest of my life in that state of terror. Permanent terror. And as I live it now, and the knowledge that my lovely child is dead. Your guilt is nothing compared to what you did to me.
The other unique selling point in The Street was that because of the structure, that it's a separate story each week, you were getting these fantastically famous actors, Oscar-nominated, etc., Jim Broadbent, Anna Friel, Bob Hoskins would come in. Was that planned, or was that just how it turned out?
Well, I like to think it was a good script, you know what I mean? I had to laugh at Bob Hoskins, because he said he has a test he uses. Have you heard about the Bob Hoskins test? He reads everything on the lavatory, and if he gets a numb bum, he knows it's good. But he got a numb bum reading that episode. I don't know the world of actors. They frighten me. You know, I don't understand them. But I think to come in and work for something like 13 days and get off again suits them down to the ground, that the, you know, that they're not chained to something that's going to go on for years. So I think that helps as well, you know. So, but I like to think, a lot of them came in for the script. I know Hoskins did, you know.
If we look to the future of TV, there's all this talk now about Mobisodes for mobile phones and dedicated websodes going online. Are you interested in any of that, or do you just want to put television there?
I haven't got a mobile phone, you know. I haven't got a car, but I can use the internet. I can get on the internet. But for me, TV is in your living room, and the screen's there, and you watch it, and hopefully you're enthralled by it, you know, because it can still do wonders. At its best, it can do wonders, you know. That's TV for me. I don't want to watch it over a mobile phone or anything, you know. No, I don't know. I think we'll always do that, though. I think we'll always sit down of a night and watch TV.
Finally, we talked a lot and properly about Catholicism in this, because it's there in the work, but... You're into your 60s now. You're supposed to think, I think it's in the catechism, isn't it? You're supposed to think about last things, aren't you, over the next 20, 30 years or so. How much of a mark does it leave on you, Catholicism?
I don't know. I've been thinking more and more about it. I haven't really thought it through enough to answer that. Whether I'd be on my deathbed sobbing, bring me a priest, I am sorry, if there is an afterlife. I hope I'm brave enough to believe this. I'll be up there with a few scripts, and those scripts